Reading from the Gospel of John.
Reading this morning is from John chapter 6, verses 56 through 69, and it's on page 868 in your pew Bible. Jesus said, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever." He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe, for Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, 'For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father.' Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him." So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
I can never hear that text without thinking of the LBW, the Green Book. Before a text was read, when I was growing up, it was, "Alleluia, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, alleluia." Maybe we should bring that up, bring that back. Maybe not. There are those pieces. Gabe's like, yeah. As we think of this text and the ways that John chapter 6 have shaped our summer together as a family of faith, we come into the last part of this bread of life text. He'd been healing sick people, so crowds began to follow Jesus in droves. And he used this moment in his ministry to clarify to these masses of people who he really is and what really is, what truly is on offer from God to all these people. It's kind of like a moment when all the billboards in your life, all the social media that's come to you through your phone, all the commercials that you've heard or seen, all the word of mouth that's been working on you, it's kind of like that moment when it all comes together and you find yourself in that place, in the presence of that person, whatever it is, a new store, a restaurant, or you start to actually tune in to an unfamiliar political candidate or whatever. And it's a crucial moment when all that work to get you in a place, you're there. And now that you're there, does the place feel like somewhere you could do business? Does the place feel like it's a place where the people are trustable? Is this for me? I remember as a kid, we moved to a new community when I was 10 years old, and my family was church shopping, and we walked into the first church that we got to in town, and we walked into the back, and on one side of the room were all the men, and on the other side of the room were all the women, and my mom turned to my dad and said, "No." And Was this a place that she felt comfortable? Her answer was no, right? For thousands that are in the presence of Jesus for the first time, like they're in his presence, they find themselves with this person they've heard a lot about, but they don't receive a sales pitch from him. Instead, Jesus gives them an experience, a miraculous feeding, where 5,000 and many more are provided with such abundance that there's leftovers. And the response of this enormous crowd is that they look at each other and they say, oh, yeah, this guy is the guy. He's the real deal. Get him! They want to make him their king. They want to draft him into service. But Jesus isn't interested in sitting on some worldly throne, wielding tribal power, responsible for only Israel's health, wealth, and happiness. So Jesus escapes. But the lesson he is in the midst of teaching is nowhere near complete. When they finally catch up with him the next day, the crowds are still just as hungry the next day as they were the day before. Jesus had given them an experience of spiritual food, spiritual drink, sustenance for their life, beyond life, but in chasing him down to be their king, to do what they thought was a magic trick again, you know, do it again, Jesus, to be what they wanted him to be, the crowds exposed how deeply they did not get it at all. Yet, they would, because Jesus would teach them. Believe in the one whom God has sent, Jesus said. Believe here is not only done in one's head, but in one's feet, in one's hands. We believe by following. Jesus is basically saying, follow me, entrust your whole lives to me. That's believe to Jesus. Their question is basically, why should we? And his answer is, because I am the bread of life. So John chapter 6 is the bread of life chapter that makes it clear he has not come to be Israel's king or a magician or a genie ready to grant wishes. The word has become flesh, as John's first chapter says so poetically, so that Jesus can be the bread of life for the whole world, for everyone in it. Because, he says, those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me and I in them. That's how our text for today begins. And that sentence is a world changer. Believe in this Jesus. Trust in him. Follow him. Eat his body and drink his blood, and there is. And I want you to hear the word is with a capital I and a capital S. There is a holy communion. We kind of go over that phrase without thinking about it very much when we call this holy communion. An abiding is to be had between God, the one true God that created everything, source of all life. There is an abiding to be had between God and little old you, little old us. Believe in Jesus, trust in him, follow his ways, experience, not just told at you, but experienced in you through eating his body and drinking his blood. And the communion shared between God and us is not symbolic or theological. This communion is. That's what Jesus is saying. That this connection God is willing to make through the body and blood of Jesus is. It's been a multi-day immersion experience with Jesus, giving the crowds enough time to really internalize this amazing offer Jesus is claiming. An offer they can't understand because it's not understandable, but an offer that they get to their credit. By verse 60 in chapter 6, it seems like they've really heard him. They've come into the Jesus showroom. They thought he was going to show them some really shiny new things, you know, political power and military might and at least a way to get ahead in this life. But they really heard him that he has not come to simply give them more pleasures or privilege or power. Instead, this word become flesh has come to abide in them and they in him, a holy communion. But do they want that? That's the question. Because they came into the showroom for healings. You know, Jesus had this reputation for healing people, and that really grabbed their attention. They're like, oh, we need... And there was no ibuprofen then, you know? But now that they've experienced the full presentation, they understand Jesus is not offering a product that they can take home. Jesus is not offering a product they can use when they feel like it and then put it away safely when they don't feel like it. Jesus is offering himself always, all the time, in all places, and that's a lot. Do we want that? Understanding what exactly Jesus is offering, many of his disciples, John says, many of his disciples say, this teaching is difficult. Who can accept it? That's an understatement. And honest. Because they thought they might be able to get something out of this Jesus at no cost to their own lives. But that's not how abiding with God works. Like, abide in a God who always works for justice and peace, who always seeks to lift up the lowly and bring hope to the hopeless. And we can't just do nothing, you know? We will be drawn in to doing acts of mercy. We're going to be drawn in to saying words of grace to each other. We're going to be drawn into living a life that is love. Jesus is not a vending machine that kick it hard enough and he's going to spit out something you think you want. Jesus is not a lottery ticket that we get to cash in at the end to claim, oh, I won eternal life, it's for me. Jesus is God become human, word become flesh. And just as I'd be insulting my wife if I just expected her to do whatever I think wife things are in order to make my life easier, that wouldn't go over very well. We insult God when we just expect God, do God things to make my life what I want it to be, without expecting that we would do God's work ourselves, that we would do mercy, that we would do grace, that we would do love work ourselves. God does not stoop down from the heavenly places, become human, live on earth, and die as a criminal for us to simply be like, so, do I get to go to heaven when I die? As though it's all about me? As if it's only about that death moment when I admit I won't have control then? We're never in control, like the whole time. Jesus promises to be our daily bread so that whatever happens next in this life that we do not control, we don't control one moment of it. Whatever happens next, whether it's cancer or a new baby in our family somewhere, an earthquake or peace like a river, the word becomes flesh so that we would abide in him and him in us always, through all of it, for forever. Not just for the part when we have kids, not just for the part when it's convenient, not just for the parts when we feel like it. Through all of it. God does not offer a one-time transaction through Jesus or even a five-time punch card. By abiding in us and we in God, God offers transformation, which is an ongoing, lifelong project. And so, many of the disciples who had crowded in, they get it. And they're now saying, ooh, this teaching is difficult. Who can accept it? Is transformation what we want? Jesus all up in our lives? I mean, I know they need transformation, but me? How about you? This gospel wants your answer. There's a few moments in John's gospel when you as a reader are brought to this question: should I stay or should I go? Since you're here, my guess is there's at least a part of you that says, I want to stay. I want to accept this difficult teaching. But speaking for myself at least, sometimes I feel like I'm one of the crowd that's complaining. Each week I confess some level of rejection, if not complete betrayal. I too often am guilty of wanting to get something from God for nothing. Just, God, make stuff right, you know? Like, clear up those storms and soften those hearts and make the world around me better. And can I be so bold as to ask for a few healings for people I care about? Too often I'm not dwelling in the Word become flesh, grateful for the peace and mercy and joy of Jesus to abide in me as I abide in Him. More often than I'd like to admit, I pray something like, hey God, fix that. Do your God work. Like, right there. And there. And you missed a spot there. This teaching is difficult. That Jesus is simply and profoundly the bread of life, able and willing to be in communion, holy communion with us, transforming us in an ongoing lifelong project, in a relationship that will transform me from much that is quite comfortable and very happy, blissfully blind to injustice and carefree about issues that seemingly do not affect me. Abiding in Jesus will have me see and know and care about others. And that is difficult. This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it? Well, here's my best pastoral advice on how to accept this difficult teaching. Don't try to accept it all by yourself. Don't do it all by yourself. Like, how many tasks and experiences must we do and have before we figure out that lifestyles, life choices, things we do, things we stand for, they're best done in groups? Like, want to break an addiction? Data shows you're far more likely to become whole again with the help of a mentor, a friend, an accountability partner, a group. Same thing for weight loss. Same thing for getting into the habit of regular exercise. Shoot, I couldn't have passed high school physics without a study group every morning. I mean, following Jesus, being transformed from a sinner to a saint, this does not happen overnight, and this is not only individual work. Yes, there are moments when it's just Jesus and Jason, you know, for sure. But those moments in my relationship with God only happen because of moments I have with Jesus and Carla, and other moments I had with Jesus and my grandparents, and other moments I had with Jesus and you at family camp or on the youth gathering last month or even here in weekly worship. I've had some beautiful moments with God, just me and God. But Jesus knew right away to not just call one disciple at a time. He called a pair of brothers, then another pair, till he had 12 in all. And then the group got a lot bigger from there. And then there were churches. And that's still how following Jesus works. Not just as billions of individual lone wolf followers, but as a church of billions, made siblings in Christ through baptism, called to encourage each other, called to abide in Christ together. Together we can accept the difficult teachings of Jesus that are harder than we'd like, teachings that are outside our imaginations, teachings that make us want to disbelieve or even reject it sometimes. No one of us can accept the fullness of Jesus' teachings alone. So here's my encouragement at the end of this 5-week journey through John chapter 6. Be faithful about how you spend your time, which includes being thoughtful about who you spend your time with. The teachings of Jesus are indeed difficult. Accepting them, remembering the joy and the peace that Jesus offers, can be hard to do if we don't regularly return to our place in the body of Christ, surrounding ourselves with others who are also struggling to be transformed. Worship together. Sing in our choir together. Eat between services together. Meet in small groups together. Teach Sunday school together. Show up to a sibling in Christ's game or play or event. Become a part of a faith web together when we get there in September. Write a card to somebody. Make a call to somebody. It can get easy to forget that we are being transformed, which is why we return again today, together. It's why we do it every week, together, to commune together with God and with each other, that we would remember that Jesus abides in us and we in him. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing.